Very good afternoon to all, brothers and sisters in the Dhamma. So today is the 7th of June, 2020, Sunday. We will continue our sharing of the unique Dhamma code, straight from the heart, from my book. We are at page 35, unique code 127. From zero comes one, and this one is the first thought of ignorance that gives rise to the infinity of subsequent creative consciousness. Then, like the Buddha said, inconceivable is the beginning of the first thought of ignorance that conditions life. So this first thought of ignorance that conditions the primordial nature into delusion, the beginning of creation. So this one, according to the Buddha, unless you are Sammasambuddha, you cannot understand. So he called it the inconceivable beginning. So inconceivable is the beginning of the first thought of ignorance that conditioned life until living being become what we are. So this process is really long. Then the next quote is, the mundane mind is a tool for one to come to this existential world, and one must learn to use it with wisdom and not be deceived by it. So this one has been explained before. To start to develop the understanding of the Buddha Dhamma and meditation, we need to understand that we have two minds. First is the supramundane mind, or the true mind, the silent mind, the meditative mind. And the other one is the creative aspect, which is the result of causes and conditions. We call it the mundane mind, dependent originating mind, condition arising mind, or what we just call the thinking mind. So that one is the worldly mind, dependent originating, condition arising, causal phenomenon, exhibiting the characteristic, the universal characteristics of impermanent. If you attach and cling, wanting things your way, leading to suffering. And because it's impermanent, it's not a permanent, unchanging entity that you can say, this is me, this is I, therefore all this can be mine. There is no such thing. The Buddha said, this is self-delusion, Sakkaya Ditti. There is no being inside there. Because this human being, or five aggregate of form and mind, they are dependent originating condition, rising cause of phenomenon. They keep on evolving, evolving, evolving. So you cannot say this is a permanent unchanging entity and cling onto it and attach. Now if you do that, you will suffer, because that is delusion. So this understanding is very important. That's why when you see this very clearly, then you understand the mundane mind is a tool for me to come to this existential world. And one must learn to use it with wisdom, but not to be deceived by it. If you are deceived by it, means you believe it is you, the aggregates of mind, the five aggregates, rupa, vedana, sanya, sangra, vinya. You think it's real, you think it's you. That is delusion, self-delusion. That's how living beings get themselves entangled. And when they get themselves entangled, they created their own suffering and misery through their own ignorance or delusion. But when you develop the understanding of it through meditation, through understanding the teaching, and when you silence your mind to meditate, you will understand and you will awaken. The moment you awaken, then you will understand what I try to mean. that this mundane mind is a tool for one to come to this existential world, and one must learn how to use it with wisdom. So you use it. The user is very important, but not to be deceived by it. If you don't have the wisdom, the Dhamma, you can be deceived by it, and you can be afflicted because of the delusion. Okay, then we move on. One's mind can only do one thing at a time. Either one is silent and aware within, or one is lost in thought, heedless. This one is very clear when you meditate. When you silent your mind, you will see it very clearly. It's either you are aware within, without thought, or your thought has arisen, preoccupied what you are thinking, perceiving, reacting, chattering, and all those things. So when you do all those things, you are no longer aware, you are lost in thought, means you are heedless. So this is meditation. To have the ability to see all this will give you the understanding, the wisdom as to how you function as a human being. What are you? Who are you? Is the fine, angry, or forming mind really you? So all this you will develop the understanding. Then the next unique code is, what is a phenomena? I think this we have gone through. Huh? You have to listen to the definition. Anything perceivable by the mind or our senses is a phenomena. So with that definition, it's very easy. Our mind has the power of perception. So whatever we come to perceive is a phenomena. You can perceive them through your seeing consciousness, hearing consciousness, smell, taste, tactile, and thought consciousness. So perception is the one that gives rise to the phenomena. So the phenomenal world of consciousness arises through perception. Then the next unique quote is, there are three basic phenomena that is, physical phenomena, mental phenomena, and nature's phenomena. So these three are very complete. Whatever that involves our physical movement, physical activity is called physical phenomena. Whatever that involves the mental perception is a mental phenomena. Or your thought process, sensation, the movement, and all the other external, they are nature's phenomena. There is no permanent unchanging entity behind every phenomenon. This one is very important. So when you awaken, you are no longer deluded. Then you understand this clearly. There is no permanent unchanging entity behind every phenomenon in this universe. That is why it is just a phenomenal world of consciousness created by mind, the mundane mind. Hence not so clear or so real and not what one thing. So this one is the meditative wisdom. You can come to understand all this if you meditate. Okay, Dhammapada verse. Not verse. Unique code number 131. 132, sorry.
132, you just say.
Yeah, we haven't finished. Yeah? There is no permanent unchanging entity behind every phenomenon. That is why it is just a phenomenal world of consciousness created by mind, the mundane mind. Hence, not so real and not what one thing. So this one is for you to develop the wisdom, understanding. Then unique code 133. This one you have to listen attentively. If you understand this, you will understand meditation. It's very easy. That's how Han come to understand recently. When thoughts slow down, there is less thinking. The mind is less clouded by perception, feeling, emotion, and attachment due to less ignorance. Mindfulness will be more stable, leading to clarity of mind. Then the direct seeing of the reality or the phenomenal, the physical, mental, and nature's phenomena will become very clear. So all this is a natural consequence of your cultivation. When you start to make progress, you will witness all this, you will understand all this. Then Unicode 134. When the mind is silent, there is no word. The mind that is silent will insight into phenomena and awaken. When the silent mind insight into the truth and the reality, it awakens. Then it can relate to the Dhamma straight away. And straight away, one will understand what Dhamma is. Verse 136, Unicode. When one experiences the silent mind or the true mind, one will come to understand that without self-delusion, the true mind, which is already naturally peaceful, still, silent, and aware within, will not stir. So this understanding is very important, otherwise you can't meditate. Next is verse 137. When one awakens to that state, the true mind can see things as they are without words and conditioning. Then verse 183 is, oh sorry, 138 is, when cultivating daily mindfulness, do not try to know. The moment you are in sati, your form and mind will understand. So this is to remind cultivator that you have to remain relaxed, aware, that's it. Don't try to know, no need to do anything else. Okay, I will read through verse 137 again. When one awakens to that state, the true mind can see things as they are, without words, and the mind will understand. So this one is, while cultivating, when one awakens to that state, the true mind can see things as they are without words and conditioning. Means you can see things as they are, without the conditioning, views, opinion, and labeling or words. Then verse Unicode 138. While cultivating daily mindfulness, do not try to know. The moment you are in sati, your form and mind will understand. That's why I just do. Do until the sati come. Do until your mind enters sati. When you are walking, just mindfully walking, meditating, mindfully meditating, develop awareness, awareness, awareness. That's it. Don't try to know. So if you can do that, your mind will enter sati and you will become very different. So while cultivating daily mindfulness, do not try to know. The moment you are in sati, your form and mind will understand. So as I have advised a lot of Paramita, even when you do bowing also, same. Just bow, don't try to know. Walking, same. Then contemplation, same. Silence your mind. Develop your ability to be aware. Then whatever that goes on in the form and mind, you will see it very clearly. Then if you are in sati all the time, you will awaken. Yeah. Then meditation becomes easy. Okay? Otherwise you will entangle yourself. Then verse 139. One has to learn to accept people for what they are, to see things as they are. One has to come to terms with the realities of the moment, to accept what is. So this one is for those who have already done it. Eh? The daily mindfulness already very stable. Eh? Then you can have all this wisdom at the moment of sense experience. You can accept people for what they are, so that you can see things as they are. Then one has to come with term. Sorry, one has to come to term with the reality of the moment, to accept what is. Now, what is the reality. When condition is set, the outcome of it will be such. No other way. Okay, the next unit quote. 140. Deluded people will say deluded thing. Angry people will say angry thing. And selfish people will do selfish thing. Hence, people are just the way they are. And the world is the world, because when conditions are like that, or suchness, the outcome of things will tend to be like that too. So this is suchness. Okay, the next verse. Unique code 141. So this is an extension of the earlier description. People are just the way they are. Then one will not get angry with them, because one can accept them for what they are, even though they say or do. Sorry. I read again. One can accept them for what they are, even though what they say or do may not be right or appropriate. Yeah. So just now I read wrongly. So correction. Verse, unit code 142. When there is complete acceptance of what is, one will be at peace. And this one you will be able to find out. You will be able to develop the understanding. Then you transform, you straighten your view, you become different. So when there is complete acceptance of what is, one will be at peace. No more reaction of mind to condition anger, hatred, conflict, fear, and suffering. This is right view. Thought is consciousness and is content. So the content are feeling, perception, mental activity, and consciousness. And this one is equal to the five aggregates of form and mind. This mental five aggregates of form and mind is your thought process. So this is the second aspect of the five aggregate of form and mind. Okay. Next code. Okay. Unit code 144. And this one is to explain to you what Sankara is. So most people don't understand what Sankara is. Okay. There are four English words used to explain Sankara, and they are mental activity, mental volition or mental intention, mental states or moods and emotion, and mental formation, which are images. They still do not completely define Sankara. In fact, everything that the mind can do, including your mental planning, scheming, cunningness, etc., apara, sankara. So this definition of sankara is very important. The content of consciousness, or whatever that your mind can do, mundane can do, is sankara. So sankara is the content of consciousness. Everything that the mind can do is sankara. Feeling and perception are also part of sankara. Consciousness is the receptacle. Therefore, in short, the four aggregates of mind, nama, are only sankara, consciousness, or vijnana. So sankara plus the content, sankara is the content of consciousness. Then sankara plus the receptacle, the consciousness, they become that vijnana or thought process. Okay, verse 146. Everything you see and perceive is via your pure consciousness. Then you input the content of consciousness to transform it into a thought, which is your five aggregates of form and mind. It is this five aggregate of form and mind that consists the world. That created the world. It is this five mental aggregates of form and mind that created the world and everything else that you come to perceive. All knowing comes from mind. There is a reason why the Buddha said, mind is the foreigner of all things. Mind is chief. And when mind arises, all things arise. Okay, I think we stop at page 40. I think we have our meditation earlier, so that we will be able to continue for a longer session later. So now it's about 3:30. Maybe we can have our meditation first. After we will continue from 147. Okay, I will give you 45 minutes for meditation. I will set the alarm until 4:15. We'll have 45 minutes. We are off the light. So always remember, relax, maintain awareness, and let the mind settle down. No need to know anything, no need to do anything. Then experience the silent mind. Experience the mundane mind slowing down until it becomes very quiet, very still. You can slowly, mindfully come out of the meditation. By now, you should be very calm, very peaceful, very still. You should have been with your true mind, the silent mind, for the last 40 to 45 minutes. For those who can have that, it means you are able to stabilize your silent mind, then you are able to experience what that true mind is when it's completely still without thought. Initially, there is this awareness nature, and it's just aware. Then you can stay at the heart, you'll be aware of the heartbeat or whatever. And whatever senses, if it's a more forceful impact of sense data, then you can be aware there too. Then sometimes whatever tactile sensation that arise, the awareness can be aware of it too. So learn to observe this, how the mind that is just aware, or the awareness nature, become aware of things. Then when you start to have the ability to be aware, you start to understand many things. You start to see reality as it is, not in accordance with your thinking, your thought process, your conditioning, your views, your opinion, belief system, no more. You will start to understand things differently. in accordance with what actually happened. Then you will start to understand the essential Dhamma very easily. The words become very clear to you. And the Pali word, the meaning also become very different. It become like very clear to you because you see them all. Then you can understand them. You don't really need people to explain to you. And for those who see, they always see, they will understand. They can use whatever word. Or people can describe it in whatever manner. The one that has realized will know what that thing is. Then you cannot lie. You cannot cheat. You cannot deceive. But that is the way things are. So the awareness nature is very different from the thinking, the thought, the knowledge. Just like what Pokching come to understand. Sister Han from Singapore. Okay, we will now continue from where we stop. We were at unit code 147, yeah. Or 144. Or 147, eh? Oh no. I haven't finished 144. Oh, I was about to finish 144. I finished 146. The Buddha said, mind is a foreigner all thing. So everything you see and perceive is via your pure consciousness. Then you input the content of consciousness to transform it into a thought, which is your five aggregates of form and mind. It is these five mental aggregates of form and mind that created the world and everything else that you come to perceive. All knowing comes from mind. That is the reason why the Buddha say, mind is the forum of all things. So now you understand. Then 145 also I will repeat. I will go through it so that you understand. Sankara is the content of consciousness. Everything that your mind can do is sankara. Feeling and perception are also part of sankara. Consciousness is the receptacle. Therefore, in short, the four aggregates of mind, the nama aspect, are only sankara plus the receptacle consciousness, which is the pure viññāṇaṁ. So here, viññāṇaṁ is the pure consciousness, the receptacle, before the content went in. That's why in the paticca-samuppada, the 12th link, the 3rd link. First link is abhijja, ignorant. Dependent on ignorance, the Buddha said, you arise thinking, mental activity, sankhara. So abhijja, paccaya, sankhara. And to think means to make contact with the brain, because human beings normally think using memory, activating the brain, the memory. Otherwise, you cannot think. The reason being, you can see with your awareness how thought arises. Thought actually is response from memory. Without memory, there is no thought. So thought is of the past, which your memory has accumulated. Otherwise, it cannot create thought. If it's nothing within your memory's dictionary, the thought cannot arise. Let's say you come to experience something or perceive something that you have never seen before or never known before. There is no word, no concept, nothing. The thing is new. You cannot create a thought out of it. But the enlightened being is different. They can look at it. They understand it, but they don't need words to understand it. They don't need concept. They don't need knowledge. They see things as they are, finished. Away. That's it. But the mundane world, the mundane society needs word, need concept. Because thought need all this. So thought is response to memory. That's the reason why you need memory. So the third link comes about is because of that. Avijja paccaya sankharam. When there is ignorance, this mundane mind will think. Because when you don't understand the truth, the reality, you want to know. You want to experience. One thing to know, one thing to experience is a craving. And you go and think because you believe by thinking you can understand. Yeah, you try to find words to describe the thing, to explain the thing, to enable you to understand. So when you think means you make contact with the brain, like the physics experiment. Upon contact, the light bulb lights up. You become conscious of what you think, your thought consciousness. Yeah. Then if you are seeing something and you want to understand what you see, then it is the seeing consciousness, the consciousness like. So the thought consciousness can be thinking consciousness, can be the seeing consciousness. So like the Buddha said, in the seeing, it is the seeing consciousness. No one to see at all. At that moment, it's just vinyanam. It's a sankara paccaya vinyanam, the pure consciousness. The receptacle before the content went in. Then when the content went in with your views, opinion, and conditioning, where you act according to memory, which is full of your views, opinion, conditioning, scars of memory, and all those accumulated rubbish. Then the content went in before you have the wisdom because you are not enlightened yet. But for the enlightened one, they don't act according to memory. They act according to wisdom, their own understanding. That's why the content of consciousness that go in will be without ignorance, without delusion. But for normal human being, because of ignorance, it will condition nama rupang. So the content of consciousness go in, the pure vinyanang become the five mental aggregates of form and mind. And the Buddha call it the thought, THOUGHT, is the thought. The thought is actually citta, citta. So namarupa is actually the second aspect of the five aggregates of form and mind. Because within the pure consciousness and the content, there are only four aggregates. Vedana sanya sankara vinyanam. But the perception aggregate sanya brings the external form into the mind and form the thought. That's why the perception, the phenomenal, what is a phenomenal? Anything perceivable by the mind is a phenomenon. That's how the thought created the phenomenal world. That's how phenomena come in. Then you have the four mind aggregate plus the mental form. It becomes the five mental aggregates of form and mind. And this is how that fourth link arise. So that is every instant, every moment, where that thought is instantaneous. You don't have to explain it over the three lifetime, the commentary type of explanation, because it can be explained in real life. In the midst of life and meditation, you can understand and you can see it. These links are very clear when you are mindful, when you are aware. Then when you start to see this, you will understand the paticca-samuppada as taught by the Buddha is instantaneous, multidimensional, not what people believe and not what people think. So all this understanding is very beautiful. My daughter is trying to get you the twirling chant. So I will go through again, then you understand. So the first link, as you can see, avijja paccaya sankhara. From here, it will condition activity of mind, which is sankhara. So avijja is ignorant, depend on ignorant, wanting to know, wanting to understand, you think. Because you believe by thinking, you can understand. So what is thinking? Thinking is basically mental activity, sankhara. So this mental activity is what contact is all about. Because when you start to think, you make contact with the brain. And the brain is the one which is the organ of the mind. Because memory, everything is there. And thought is respond to memory. That's why from there, the content of consciousness went in. So initially, before the content of consciousness went in, it's just the pure vijnana. As I sankara pachya vijnana. So this vijnana is the third link. So here, like the Buddha said, in the seeing, it's just the seeing consciousness. There is no egoic mind, no one to see. Then in the hearing, is only the hearing consciousness, the pure consciousness, no one to hear. But when the egoic mind come in, means the content of consciousness went in, then it become conditioned into nama rupa. Nama rupa is the fourth link, and this is what the thought is all about. That's why thought is respond to memory. So this is what the thought is all about. So this is sankara plus vijnana. Means the content of consciousness has gone in. The vijnana, the receptacle, has received the content. That's how it becomes the thought. And this is also the second aspect of the five aggregate of form and mind. Second aspect. Five aggregates of form and mind. Yeah? Then dependent on this, there must be sense basis. Otherwise, the consciousness cannot arise. That's why this next link, number five, sense basis, is a natural consequence of it, yeah? By induction. Otherwise, the form and mind cannot arise. The thought cannot arise. The sense experience cannot arise. So this salayatana must be there, the sense basis. So this six sense basis is inclusive of the mind, the brain. Yeah, the five physical senses and the brain. Then from the sense basis, you need contact, the Buddha said. There must be contact. So that's why the sixth link is this direction giving you contact. So when contact arises, there is feeling. It conditions the next link, feeling. Then feeling, condition, craving. Craving, condition, grasping. Grasping, condition, become. You become that thing. Like when you become very lustful. Means you become the anger or your that hatred or that lust. Then that becoming will actually condition you into birth. This birth is what they call transgression. Transgression.
It's like when people say a genius is born.
Transgression means you become that thing, you transgress and you are born into it. Means the lustful mind take birth and become the rapist. That is transgression. Or it become the angry person, scolding that person. So the anger has transgressed into violence. So transgression can be in the form of action, speech, and thought process. So if it's the thought process, it's lust, then it transgress into that lustful nature, which is the nature of a rapist. That's why you start to rape people, you start to kill people, you start to harm people, you start to become violent, become very, very emotional. You speak harshly, you speak angrily, the hatred and all things come up. So taking birth here doesn't mean you are reborn into another life. So the link number 10, number 11 is not understood. Becoming means you become that anger or that lust or that fear or that hatred. That is what becoming is all about. So feeling, condition, craving, the grasping, the emotion and all those things, then that one become very strong. That craving become very strong. You grasp at it. Obsessive or then you want to do it really. That's why you become that lust. You become that anger, that hatred. And then you take birth, transgression. Means it has gone beyond mental state. It has transgressed into external manifestation through physical, whether action, speech, or thought process. Then you become that thing. Then after that, you take birth, and it creates the whole mess of suffering. So all this old age sickness and death leading to sorrow, lamentation, all this is the result of your transgression. So this part has been wrongly explained by the commentaries. Because they find it very difficult to explain the 12 link without the 3 period of time. Because the 3 period of time make the teaching very easy to explain, very straightforward. But when I realized it in the year 1989, I realized something is not right. Because how can Patichasamuppada be taught this way? If it's taught this way, it doesn't serve the purpose. If it happened only once over 3 lifetimes, then I learned it for what as a theory. No use. But what I saw was every moment, every instant in the midst of life. Then sometimes it doesn't finish. And this is multi-dimensional, not a single dimensional. Sometimes the link doesn't finish. Another sense, the activity take over. Then it doesn't mean that every time it will hit craving. The enlightened being don't have craving. Feeling become pure feeling. It stop here, number 7. This one become pure feeling for enlightened being. So this pure feeling is not the usual grasping one. Upadana kandas. So this one is pure aggregate, pure feeling. That's why their aggregates, their Vedana are non-grasping. So when their Vedanas are non-grasping, it cannot condition craving. You don't have to do anything. Where the wisdom free you, you don't have to cut a feeling so that you won't crave. No such thing. What is there to cut? When you already not deluded, when there is no more ignorant. Do you understand? When you are no longer deluded, your feeling can remain as pure feeling. It does not stir your mind. It does not make you reactive. Your mind is at peace. That's how you can stay there with an pure feeling. That's why the Arahant, the aggregates are non-grasping. Whereas the non-enlightened being, the 5 aggregates of form and mind are grasping aggregate, upadana khandas. That's why in the final summary of the first noble truth, the Buddha always summarized all of suffering as attachment to the 5 aggregates of form and mind. He said, it is this upadana khandas that I call dukkha, the grasping aggregate. The word is grasping, upadana, upadana. Before it becomes grasping, it's not serious yet. Craving is not serious yet. But the enlightened being will not have that craving. Because craving is a desire. So it's just like in life. When you need to eat, there is need. Understand? That's why you can feel the body need food. There is hunger. And you eat because the body needs. And sometimes we eat because we like the food. We like the taste. It's okay. But don't go and attach to it and grasp onto it. Once it becomes upadana, khandas, you better be careful. Because this tanha, if there is delusion, it will become grasping, upadana. But if there is no delusion, you can have the good food. You can have the good life. You can have that nice feeling. Anasana. And this is non-grasping. This is just an experience. Yeah. That's why it can be pure feeling. And that sensation can be very nice feeling, very nice sensation. But it's not a craving. Because you understand, when there is condition to have good food, you can have it. But you will not overeat, you will not indulge. You will know your limit. Because the body will tell you, no matter how good that thing is, after a while, if you overeat, it will give you a problem. Then you will know it's foolish to do that. It's actually in a form a delusion. But because of the wisdom, they are not so deluded and ignorant to the extent that it can continue to condition them into upadana, grasping. They cannot. After that, they will stop. They will stop. They know enough already. That's why a lot of people come out with, you eat 70%, 七分饱. But most people cannot. They eat until 90%, 100%. Then some 110%. Yeah, when they like the food, they continue to eat. But then when they start to feel the reaction from the body, then they know they have overeaten. So all these things, as a human being, as you go through life, you can develop the understanding. Then as your wisdom arises, you become different. You will not be the normal human being who is deluded, who has the ignorance, who will continue to create problem for themselves. Yeah. You will stand above and you can become different. Yeah. In that sense, wisdom liberates the mind. Wisdom frees the mind. So without wisdom, you will get yourself entangled. Yeah? Okay, we go back to the code, yes, the unique Dhamma code. Okay.
We finish
145, 146, okay. Then we also finish 147, Oh, not yet. 147, okay. Ability to understand the five aggregates of form and mind can free one's mind from the delusion of self. This one is very true. The two aspects of the five aggregates of form and mind. First aspect is as a human being or a living being. We have a physical body. Then we have a consciousness trapped inside. So there is four more aggregates in the mind. They are Vedana, Sanya, Sankara, Vijnana. So together with the physical body, you have the five aggregate of form and mind. Yeah. Then the second aspect is the form is the mental form, is the thought process. At every moment of sense experience, there is also this namarupa, five aggregate of form and mind. That is the thought. That is the second aspect of the five aggregates of form and mind. So that one, I seldom see people teach because they don't understand and the book also never write. They were described. But in the meditation, you can see them. And the Buddha is referring to that. Otherwise, it cannot be the instantaneous paticca-samuppada, the dwelling. That's why his teaching of the paticca-samuppada, the law of dependent origination, is very unique. And it's very, very beautiful teaching, very powerful teaching. It gave rise to transforming wisdom, really, really transforming. Yeah. Then you understand, when you can see clearly, then you can see the three universal characteristics, especially anicca leading to anatta. Yeah. Then when you want things your way, which is not nature's way, the second universal characteristics of suffering or dukkha also arise. That's how the three universal characteristics come to be. From understanding impermanent, you will understand dukkha and anatta. And to understand impermanent is to silence your mind, to have the ability to see things as they are, then you can see the creation from the true mind, the true nature. Everything from there it arises. Then you can start to understand all this arise because of causes and conditions. Everything is dependent, originating, condition, arising, causal phenomena. Then you realize that is how nature's law work. That is how nature's law function. That is how we function as a human being. Mental consciousness, our mind, mundane mind, how it functions. Then we understand clearly who are we, what are we, and how we function as a human being. That's how mindfulness enables us to see all this. That's the reason why the Buddha said, without mindfulness, we are dead. Mindfulness is life. For sati is life. Without sati, there is no heedfulness. Without sati, you cannot be ever mindful, constantly meditating. So heedfulness is Dhammapada verse 23. The constantly meditative and the ever mindful, they will realize the supreme born free Nibbana. So this understanding of the five aggregates of form and mind is very important. Without sati, you cannot see, you cannot understand. That's why you cannot explain the way things are. You cannot teach that teaching, the dwelling, impossible. Yeah. That's the reason why when I saw, I understood that when I start to teach, people cannot understand. People are very confused. Then it's like, this is something so new to them. They never heard of this before. But nowadays, people start to understand. Yeah, I realized there is a video based on what I teach in Cameron Highlands in one of the retreats on the Paticca-samuppada, dependent origination, the term. I realized recently a lot of people have viewed that one and they like that video. There are very few people can explain the five aggregate of form and mind and the Paticca-samuppada, the dwelling, so differently, so clearly. And that one match with the reality. People who meditate, they will understand. Straight away, they will say, this is beautiful. This is what actually happened. Okay, we will go to verse 148. Self-delusion or sakkadity is rooted out when one has penetrated the understanding of these five aggregates of form and mind. So this one is also very important. Always remember, the self-delusion or sakkadity is rooted out when one has penetrated the understanding that this five aggregate of form and mind is dependent originating. Hence, it is not a permanent unchanging entity. Therefore, it is not real, not what you think. And also, not a permanent unchanging entity that you can call, this is me, this is I. Therefore, all this can be mine. That is a real delusion. So see that clearly. Then awaken. The moment you see, you awaken, you are not deluded anymore. Then you transform. You can become enlightened. That is how people become sotapanna. To become a sotapanna is not difficult. It's really, really relatively easy. In the sense that you must have this stability of mindfulness to see and one day to awaken. The first factor that you have to severe is self-delusion, sakkadity. When you see this, the other two factors automatically will go. The faith in the triple gem become automatic. Then rite and ritual, they cannot lie to you anymore. They cannot deceive you. When they tell you if a person die or when you die, you will become ghost. You will become one another. You know this guy don't understand because no one die, nothing die. All those fellow who talk about this, ghosts and non-human and all that thing, doesn't understand. They think that one is real. That's why they have all this story to tell you. But for the enlightened being, they understand, he know you, he know me. This is delusion. It's just for my mind, for my mind. When there is ignorant, evil condition, rebirth, the rebirth consciousness will continue. Then there is a new birth. But when there is no ignorance, the form of mind cease. Then the Arahant and beyond, they realize enlightenment, Nibbana, or we call it Parinibbana. They will go through that cessation of form of mind. They realize Parinibbana, no more rebirth. But for the Bodhisattva, it's different. Bodhisattva, even though they got no more ignorance, there is no more rebirth consciousness. But they can still come back to take birth. You can call it rebirth too. But their rebirth is born of their vow, the pure mind, pure consciousness, born of love and compassion for the living being. And that one condition, a karmic form of mind to arise. But their karmic nature is still there. And their vow can create that love and compassion, that pure thought or the pure mind. And through the vow, it will have the causes and condition to arise, that five aggregates of form and mind to take birth. That's how they come back. Only the Bodhisattva, those who take that way, know how to come back. Because this is the nature's law. This is the secret of life. You know the secret of life, you know how to come. And when you know how to come, you know how to return. That's why the Bodhisattva way can be very fulfilling. Very, very wonderful. And it's really very beautiful. They used to say this. The word is rewarding. Rewarding. The Bodhisattva way may be like to people very tedious, takes so long, eons and eons and eons of birth and death. But then it's very rewarding, rewarding in the sense that for those who have the understanding, it's so beautiful because every life you come, there is so much meaning to it, so much joy, so much happiness. And you get to fulfill all your vows. You get to develop all the understanding of life. You got to experience all the possibility of existence. So it is rewarding in the sense that it's very rich. Even though life itself is not what people think, the unreality of life and existence. But there is such thing as life, even though it's only moment to moment. And split second is dead and gone, split second is dead and gone. So how real can be life, can life be? But there is such thing as life, as existence. All this moment after you become enlightened can be very beautiful, very wonderful. And you can live the life of enlightened being, the third phase of Dhamma, Pativeda. And that is the most beautiful part of one's existence. For normally people, if you are successful in life, in fact, the moment you retire, that is the most beautiful part of your life. Because after that, you don't have to worry about money. You don't have to worry about life. You can do what you want. You can live life to the fullest. So you can fulfill your dreams, whatever that nature can allow, that you have the means to experience, you can have them. I won't use the word enjoy. You can enjoy life. Of course, if people want to use that word, no harm. But with understanding, you enjoy with understanding. So what is more important is, I always use the word, if you have the means, the ability, you can pamper yourself a little bit as well. You can really live the life that you want to live. You can experience them. Just like that show, Ticket to Indulgence, you can have all the good life and all, but you will not attach. Where you know, you can experience them when you have the means. No harm. You don't cheat, you don't lie, you don't deceive, you don't cause suffering to fellow living beings. In fact, if you have that understanding, during recession, like COVID-19, now they want economic activity, then we start to spend, we start to encourage economic activity. Like in the early days, during recession, I did my house renovation, although it's just a small amount of job, but at least it helps stimulate some form of economic activities. So when you have that understanding, you will know how to echo and flow and fit in and do what you have to do. Then every time we go out to have our lunch or dinner, sometimes I have this understanding. Sometimes I just go into the shop because I can sense not much people go in. Sometimes it's without customer. And the strange thing is, every time me or my wife go in, after that customer will come on somehow. Then sometimes I know if the owner is like honest, sincere, then I will continue to go and support the shop. And then after a while, the shop have good business activity, very strange. So that is what nature's law is all about. When you have the understanding, you know how to manifest, then people will benefit. Society will benefit. The world will benefit. So life and existence has its place within the condition world. As a bodhisattva, you will understand all this. But as a normal enlightened being who go the sainthood way, maybe these are not so important to you. Because to you, the main aim is to root out ignorance, then free your mind from birth and death. Then they believe no more suffering from then onward. How to have suffering when you don't have a form of mind to come back at the center? And if you believe you exist and you are contented with that, then it's your choice. But the way I understand it is different. We are he know you, he know me. So who is the Arahant? The form and mind with the wisdom is the Arahant. But is that you? No, that is not you. But you have a choice. The choice is to just do that and finish. But most people who just do that and finish, they don't have a choice to go the bodhisattva way because they don't have the condition to understand them and they don't have the opportunity to develop the understanding to go that way. So it depends on the individual. Whether you go that way or you don't go that way is the form and mind's decision. The form and mind that decide the overall totality of understanding means the big picture. But you need a lot of understanding and wisdom to form that understanding to go that way. Unless you have the good karma, the good affinity with great beings, and you can meet up with them, encounter more and more of them, and listen to their sharing, then it will like, what word you use? Encourage you, motivate you. I don't use the word stimulate you. That one is a wrong word. Motivate, I think. But it is like It drives you to have the faith, understand? No? Inspire. My daughter come on the right word. It will inspire you to really go this way. Yeah, it's so beautiful. So wonderful. That's why I say it's very rewarding. Even though long, but don't worry. Long according to Monday mind. But the one that has the wisdom and the understanding, understand it differently. Just when you can renounce samsara, means samsara has got no problem. Because he know you, he know me. No one born, no one die, no one sick, no one old. So you don't have to come with all this burden of life, suffering. No. When you have the understanding, every life you come is so rewarding, so wonderful. Incarnation just fall into place. Like this life, my nature, come with this form and mind. It's again so beautiful, so meaningful. Not only it can develop the understanding again, but because of the vow, it can continue to fulfill its vow to benefit living beings and to do what it wants to do. That's why all this will unfold and manifest. Then life becomes so meaningful, so beautiful. That's why from the year 1989 onward until now, it's so beautiful. All the while, it's like you are very blessed, you're very lucky, everything go your way. So this is the understanding that you will develop, and I hope this will give you faith too. Okay, we move on. The next one is 149. Unique code 149. Ability to see form, the unreality and empty nature of form will enable one to see beyond form. This one I have gone through before. Understand clearly that form are conditioned arising, go the way of nature, hence not real. Because all form exhibit the three universal characteristics of anicchang, dukkang, and anatta. Hence, one must develop wisdom, not to be deluded by form, leading to non-attachment to form. When mind comes into contact with sense organ and their respective sense data, sense or consciousness will arise or come to be. Hence, all of sense or consciousness is dependent originating. It's just a condition arising, cause of phenomena. That's why it's not a permanent and changing entity. He know you, he know me. Everything is dependent originating. Sense organ, contact, sense data, consciousness, and the physical body in proper, appropriate functioning condition. So these are the conditions that arises that phenomenon. The respective sense or conscience, that phenomena arise because of the supporting condition. If any of the supporting conditions cease to be, it will cease to be. It cannot arise. That's why you see how things arise and how things cease and how things sustain itself when the condition supporting it continue to sustain it. So you will start to see this very often until you awaken, until you understand it deeply, that everything is like that, dependent, originating, condition, arising, cause, no reality. He know you, he know me. That's why the no mark understanding, the second hallmark of winning, will start to arise. Then you realize you yourself, the form and mind is also like that, not real. Appearing, disappearing. With the three universal characteristics, he know you, he know me. So no mark of a self cultivating living life, no mark of others cultivating living life, no mark of Dhamma, no mark of life. Everything is just the way it is, not what you think. My make a day. So all this will become very clear to you. Okay, I think we end here. Page 41. Then after that, we will open up for meditation reporting or Q&A. If you got any question or any sharing, you can ask. Meditation reporting is more important. We have today 45 minutes. I think most of you should be able to get down to have the ability to settle down until you become very quiet, very peaceful, very still. Okay, now we open up. Anybody wants to start their sharing? You just raise your hand or you come in with your mic, while I have a drink. Anybody? Alicia, yes. Sadio, Alicia, yes. We are unmute you first.
Okay, Brad,
45 minutes of meditation helps a lot.
Okay, 其实我想分享的是，有一天，我刚刚 MCO 还在 MCO 的时候，我经过一个，我去做牙齿，然后经过一间店。然后他们就在 Happy Hour 啊、
，OK，
然后我就有一个 wrong thought， 哎呦，为什么他们还在这里 ？You know， 这样子，然后我就没有再去想，然后就回来，然后那天的晚上哦。哇，那个 chattering like you know 还在 meditation， like 早上醒来的时候。哇，为什么好像这么辛苦的嘞？为什么里面这么苦？其实看起来又其实又不是很什么的一回事。可是的那个 suffering deep inside 哦 ，like 哟，我讲不出来，就是。然后 after that，
也都到了啊
啊！我感觉到我 fully aware 到哇，为什么这么苦？然后我就问我自己，到底为什么你会这样子？那个只是一个这样子的，然后他就接下来他就是哦这样的一下哦，
就你会退回去的，你会了解的，
然后哦了哦，他就没有任何的东西了，可是
啊对对，他就灭掉了，
人的 full understanding is like how it happens， 那个里面你看到的是
对。
Law of mind 和 law of dharma 全部都在里面这样子。
对。就 manifestation。
就是这样子。
啊对。
然后就是问下不然就这个就是那个 dharma vichaya 的。
Investigation 对。对。
OK。
阿弥陀佛。
阿弥陀佛。
In English for those。Who don't understand Mandarin. So what Alicia shared just now was very good because it seems during MCO, still during MCO period, she visited a dentist, I think. Then after the appointment, she passed by the nearby shop and she saw people still happy hour, drinking and all those things. Then your habitual tendency, because her habitual tendency still think, still have that type of reaction. Then the moment that thing arises, then she realized it makes the sankhara, like kipo and asana. These are other people's activity. There is no right, no wrong. They are just the way they are. But because of that habitual tendency that wants to comment, ayo, during MCO time, you're supposed to stay at home. Why are these people still doing all this thing? So sometimes the mundane mind will continue to do that. Then she came to realize after that thought, it's like a normal day to day. A lot of heedless people do that and they do it continuously. But people who cultivate, who has transformed, once a while, the habitual tendency, that thought will still come back. Then they can be aware of it. Then they just let it be. Then this experience or thought process, it will manifest as attachment, craving, clinging. That's why she used the word, when she meditated, she realized something deep inside still not rooted out, like still creating that type of suffering. Then later on, she investigated into it where she know how to silence her mind, be at peace and find out. Then she used the word awe, means like you understand not? Then straight away that thing ceased. It because when she passed by, the habitual tendency still arise and make the comment. But when you understand Sankara, that wisdom at the moment of sense experience can actually straight away tell you, people are just the way they are. The world is the world, condition like that, things will be. So this understanding will stabilize until finally all this habitual tendency also will be rooted out. But it will take a while, because to stabilize that, to root that out, take a while. But the understanding is already there. That's why this habitual tendency sometimes take a while. Initially, it will still come back. But the moment it come back, you will understand. You don't have to do all those things. There is no need. So once she describes it's good, and she wants to know, is this Dhamma investigation, Dhamma Vichaya? Yes, this is Dhamma Vichaya. That's why you can see them. Then later on, when it's rooted out, you realize you cannot do all those things anymore. They are just the way they are. The world is the world, and you are always at peace. You will not manifest unless there is causes and conditions for you to manifest. Yeah, my daughter wants to say something.
Suddenly occurred to me that it's related to the 12 links.
Yeah.
It's a very good example to see the 12 links. I'll go there.
Mm.
So it's like you actually that one start from the sense basis.
Mm.
So you see something first from the seeing, make contact with the eye already.
Yeah.
Then you had a thought that people shouldn't be doing that. That avijja, right?
Avijja,
continue to say, wow, sankara. They are very bad. Later, they make people sick. Then continue to think, it think and then think from memories. Then recall all the news we saw. All the people getting old. All the statistics all come out. The thought, right? The nama and the rupa. All the other old people's photo, Trump's photo, all come out in our mind. You see the people happy out there and then America, the streets, people have fire on the streets, all come out here. Then continue to make contact again and then go home also. The feeling still there. So follow all the way home.
The memory.
Yeah. So the memory registered already. We may be distracted, we go and shower, whatever, for a while, then come back. Still there. So actually a bit of the craving. The craving is there already. You're already craving to the idea that people shouldn't be doing that, but the there are people
that,
doing that.
The awareness there will know.
Yeah. So if we continue to see a few more of those images in our mind, it will grasp until it will make comment at people and scold people. So, but before it went there, I think for her, it just stuck around here. Then after that,
mindfulness.
Don't want to think already. Let go of that. Let go of that wrong thought.
Feel
that this is actually making her day. Very bad. That craving is making her suffer.
The
whole day, off and on, keep thinking about it. It's actually a kind of suffering.
She can feel it.
Yeah.
Then
so
she once she understands, then the thing will turn.
Yeah. So what she explained is very good. So once that feeling become craving, the conditioning is there because memory retained. That's why whatever you comment or argue with people or you say just because you reacted or you don't like, it's already accumulated. You may not know. But the obvious one is during the early days, I remember, after that thing happened, even Dhamma discussion, when people don't agree with you, on the way back, you were still you were still thinking about it. How come these people cannot understand? Why they like that? Oh. Because you still don't have the ability to understand that they are just the way they are and not everybody is like you. That's why finally I came to understand not everybody is like my nature. That's why I accepted it and I reversed my teaching. I had to go back to very basic to teach. It's like from kindergarten. You know what is kindergarten. Before you even go to school, there is this kindergarten. So kindergarten will teach you very basic thing. Preschool, nursery. So this one, you have to learn so that you go to primary school, the ABC all become easy. Then after you have the ABC to Z, then they teach you the five vowel, A, E, I, O, U, pronunciation. Then they teach you how to sing song, how to form words. All this also, you haven't learned how to teach you English. You understand or not? So Dhamma is the same. The essential Dhamma, you haven't got it right. You haven't developed the understanding. So how to teach you the real Dhamma? Cannot. That's why I had to reverse back everything. Start teaching the essential Dhamma. Start linking up all the teaching and explain to you the whole big picture, how the teaching are all connected. From right view, everything start. And the advice of the Buddha linking to the advice to avoid all evil through keeping precept. And how, by violating precept, you commit major evil. That's why to avoid evil, you have to keep your precept. Then how to cultivate wholesomeness. That's how Noble Eightfold Path come about. Then how to purify the mind. That's why you need mindfulness, heedfulness. Sati leading to samadhi, to sitting. So the whole thing become clear. Then only you can understand the true teaching. Then only I can start to teach you how to use the essential Dhamma, to apply the essential Dhamma. Then how all these essential Dhamma are teaching that spin off from the three turning of the Four Noble Truth. That's why the three turning of the Four Noble Truth are the essential Dhamma. They are the essence of the Buddha's teaching. And from there, it's spin off. And the essential Dhamma, they are all related to the Four Noble Truth, connected back, especially the Noble Eightfold Path. The whole teaching is from there. Without Noble Eightfold Path, there is no teaching. Noble Eightfold Path is actually the advice of the Buddha to avoid all evil through right view, then to cultivate wholesomeness, also through right view, then to purify the mind, to awaken, to develop wisdom, also through right view. So all this understanding, not until you understand the essential Dhamma deeply, completely, you cannot apply that because they are all connected and linked, the big picture. You cannot see them, you treat the teaching as individual, separate teaching, you will never progress. And even the individual essential Dhamma also has been taught in a distorted way. Very few people have the understanding to teach the essential Dhamma as a one teaching, linking everything together. It's not that. Even the Paticchasamuppada is so difficult for people to understand, not to say teach. Then the three universal characteristics, this one is even more difficult. How to see form, the unreality of form, then how to develop the wisdom to see beyond form. So similarly for the aggregates of mind, how to see mind, the unreality of mind, then how to see beyond mind, then how to develop the ability to meditate, to realize the true mind, to silence everything, to return to your true nature. oneness nature. Then from there, how through the direct seeing, you awaken, you insight into normal, you develop penetrative understanding and wisdom. So all these are the teaching. Not until you have a stable daily mindfulness, not until you have trained your mind to have the ability of sati, leading to sati sambhajana, your initial wisdom cannot arise. And when your initial wisdom is not there, step 5 of avijja sutta not there, you cannot do step 6, step 7, and step 8, no way. So sense restraint is not there. Then how can you live life? How can you cope with life? Without sense restraint, you cannot have the 3 way of right conduct. Without the ability to have sense restraint and the 3 way of right conduct, there is no way you can cultivate 4 foundation of mindfulness. It means one thing. Your stability of mindfulness, daily mindfulness, is not there. Sati sampajana, the step 4 not trained. Step 5 also not developed, the initial wisdom. That's why your mind cannot settle down. Your mind cannot be within the moment, constantly aware, ever mindful. You can't. And because of that, sati sampajana cannot come to be. Daily mindfulness cannot come to be. So all the teaching are connected and interlinked. We should thank Alicia for the good sharing. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu. Okay, anybody else? Yeah, we have another 5 minutes. Anybody else wants to report their meditation or ask any question? Yeah. You just have to come in. Ah, Pamasri, yes. Yeah, Sadhu.
Matthew.
Ah, yes, Pamasri.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, yes. Yeah.
I want to report a little experience.
Ah, Sadhu.
Lying meditation.
Ah.
It was in my lying meditation. This state that my whole body is very cold.
Okay.
Went into the bones.
Oh, okay.
I silent and stay with it, aware, and then the heat come back.
Ah, Sadhu.
It came back and then it's like bubbling, and then my body is warm again.
Oh.
Then the next day it happened again. It went into deeper and my whole body like drying up. The skin sticking to the bones.
Okay.
Sticking to the bones, and then I doze off. So I came out. I have been contemplating on this experience.
Yeah.
For a week plus, I couldn't understand why this happened until recently. This is what I have contemplated. I don't know.
Yeah, your report
about the four elements of our body.
Okay.
Of this physical body, the first experience. The heat went off, no more. It is cold until inside the bones.
Okay, that's all.
The second time, even the water element also no more.
Oh, okay.
It dries up, and then I can feel very clear the skin stick to the bones, and then it's brown, dark, brownish, black in color. So, can Ratio.
Okay.
Me on this.
Next time, I advise you when this thing happens, don't allow the theory come and condition you.
But this one, the content.
Wait. You listen. After that. You listen first. Even come after that is the same, because you have already deviated from the purpose of meditation. You must always remember. These are theory that other people teach, because even though under the what they call kaya nupasana, okay, first is anapanasati, to train the mind to develop mindfulness on the in and out breath to stabilize that. Then after that, what did the Buddha say? You have to stabilize this mindfulness you have to come out of it into life and develop the mindfulness of the four posture. After the four posture, you have to connect the all the four connecting posture or the movement in between to develop the third category of cultivation, sati sampajana, means mindfulness and clear comprehension of all action, all movement within the present moment. Then after that, contemplate the four elements. Contemplate the four elements is not going into the meditation and do like that. No. Contemplate the four elements means when you are mindful and aware, not in the formal meditation. In the formal meditation, like what you went through, you feel the deep cold and the chill, means your yin yang is in balance already. You have to relax into it. Don't try to attach and cling to the experience. You are having joy and think that this is something beautiful. Then you want to understand. Forget about it. Always remember the four support. Whatever happened, relax. Relax. Otherwise, the yin-yang imbalance will manifest because you are not familiar with the understanding of meditation at that stage. You may have some good experience before, but I always tell you the experience is not the thing. The thing is the wisdom. The wisdom must come from daily mindfulness. Then only in the formal meditation with the initial wisdom, you will understand. So the four support is very important. Huh? You listen again, Pamaswari, this will help you. Relax into whatever mind state that arises. So the other thing you have to check is, it sometimes it becomes very cold and chilling. It's either the yin-yang imbalance is happening, or sometimes it could be raining, your aircon too cold. You have to check. Yeah. But based on what you describe, it's nothing to do with the aircon. Yeah, you say the warm come back. Yeah. But if you know how to relax into it and silent, the yin-yang balance will come back. Because you are trying to like develop it. That's why it go until all those manifestations, which is a delusion. It is not the Dhamma. Because the contemplation on the four elements, if you were to read the Satipatthana Sutta, is different, like the 32 part. You know what is the 32 part and all? The last time they had to look at that one. Actually, I look at the block cut analogy that the Buddha teach, I understand the 32 part straight away. I don't have to contemplate. Well, a lot of people go into that is because they have this lust. They cannot break free. So they have to contemplate, look at the skeleton, then look at the 32 part, like it's a skin bag of a very dirty thing, smelly thing else. The purpose of the 32 part is not about the foulness of the body and all those things. The purpose of the 32 part is to tell you all these parts must come together and perform a function like the bulokkha, then it arrives already. You give it a name, a human being. Bulokkha arrives already because it performs a function. You can develop it into a concept, give it a name. So that is the purpose. Then the fourth element is to tell you that this body is without consciousness. It's not you. It goes the way of nature. It is impermanent, subject to old age, sickness, and death. Where this one goes the way of nature, without consciousness, how can it be you? So the fourth element is just that. Forget about what people tell you. Early on, one lady wrote to me the meditation description. He also, but that one not so bad. At least she developed the daily mindfulness. That's why my comment to her is continue. But there was one part, you know what she described? When you are aware, like the Buddha say, walking aware, standing aware. You know what he tell me? He said, when I was walking, I can feel the coldness of the floor. All this type of description, no, is from the thought. Why you want to know? The kaya upasana is to anchor your mindfulness to your kaya. Forget about the sensation. That is vedana upasana. Why you want to mix things up? Forget about it. Just develop the mindfulness, anchor the mind. When the stability of mindfulness is there, you will become very different. You will become very sensitive. You will understand the Dhamma differently on your own. So all this theory that people teach you without understanding, when you are conditioned, you will go and look for it. That's why I say, don't try to know. Don't try to do anything. Just relax, maintain awareness, silent. Whatever mind state arrives, relax into it, maintain the silence. Then use that silent mind to develop the wisdom, the meditation. That is what meditation is all about. That is what you're supposed to do. Then when you come out of it, stabilize it during the daily mindfulness, you will see all this through silent observation, how you function as a human being, how things are dependent origin, how they arise. And that is more important than the so-called four elements. And forget about it. That one is not going to awaken you. That one is for contemplation. Like the Buddha, this body of ours is of the nature to grow old, get sick and die, for it has not gone beyond old age. Old age, sickness and death. So all this is the contemplative part. In fact, the four elements and the 32 part is a natural progression of the cultivation. The moment your four posture and your daily mindfulness is there, these four elements and 32 part is contemplative, very fast you pass by. You don't go and be conditioned by those who do jhana, can see the four elements when they are, forget about it. That one is meditative experience. Don't try to get involved in all those things. People can have their own understanding, but they can go and find out whether that one leads to wisdom or not. It's not going to lead you to wisdom. So after you know the four elements, so what? Is that going to give you wisdom, understanding, free your mind, enable you to cultivate Noble Eightfold Path? No. Then why you want to learn that? Why you want to believe that is the one that the meditation is showing you? No. The one that you should see are those meditative ones that lead to understanding one, how your craving inside there, how the defilement, how it conditions your mental state, like what Alicia they all describe. Later on you will see how Cheng they all describe. When they realize that silent mind, they will know how to use that mind to meditate and develop the understanding, and they can free their mind so that all the so-called suffering, misery, the what they call 16 years of depression that Alicia gone through, she saw them all because she experienced them. And she can develop the understanding. Because when the mindfulness came, all this become clear to her. That's why go after daily mindfulness, stabilize your mind. Then when you are in the formal meditation, don't try to develop the conditioning from what you have learned before. Forget about all those things. Start from a clean slate. Always remember that. Pamasri, I hope you can follow. Good that you report, otherwise you get stuck in it, because these four elements, a lot of people fail to understand, they get stuck. They go and try to develop that, thinking that when I can experience that, I have progressed. No such thing. Even the sensation, they say, feel the heat, feel the cold, feel the four elements. How does it give rise to wisdom? Inquire, ask yourself. If it's not giving rise to wisdom, you do it for what? With the Sankara Mande mind telling you that this equate to insight, wisdom. No. The three universal characteristics, you cannot see them in the four elements. It's like in the Satipatthana Sutta, the four elements. You know what the Buddha mentioned? There is a, don't know what type of meat, I think. Is it like a butcher, he chopped into four. Then he separate them. Then he see that these are the elements. That one is to let you understand how your physical body is composed of and how it manifests and functions. That's why there is such thing as the wind element, the breath and all those things. Then the hardness, the pathway element. So all this is just a scientific description of what the physical body is all about. And it goes the way of nature. And it needs to be supported by all this. The heat and all those things. But apart from that, it's not important. It's not for you to go and experience all this in the meditation. No, these are contemplative. Contemplate, understand, move on. The real meditative experience is the satipatthana that involves Vedana, Citta, and Dhamma Nupassana. Kaya is just to anchor the mind to develop the stability of mindfulness. That's it. Then contemplate the four elements and the 32 part to see the dependent origination, condition arising aspect of the form and mind. Then finally, even the 9 stages of 7-3 decomposition, actually you don't have to go through that. That is for certain people with certain character that find it very difficult to go beyond the attraction of form. So when they see the form decay and finally become dust, then go back to nature, return to nature, empty again, then only they lose their craving for beautiful form and all those things. It's for that purpose only. But when you have the wisdom, you can penetrate the three universal characteristics very clearly. All these will cease. Like the flower, you can see in the flower. Why you have to go and contemplate until so ugly, so dirty? And you go to China ground and cultivate. Nobody will do that now. Yeah, in the past, it's different. The Buddha's time, certain people with certain character, they need this. So they need to go. Let them go. But if you have that understanding from your cultivation, you see everything in life. You can see the ephemeral changes. The flower is the fastest. Then you can see. Then as we age, we can see how we age. That's why aging, decay, is a nature's process. So our body goes the way of nature. It grows old, it ages, subject to disease. Like the plant, the flower, everything is the same, except that theirs is faster. So when you observe life, you observe nature, you can see all this. You can then you relate it back to yourself. You maintain it better, it lasts you longer, but it will not last you forever. Like your car, no matter how well you maintain, maybe less servicing, you still need to service, maybe not so often because you take care. You have been like maintaining your car very well. So chances of problem is less, but it will happen. That's why the car under wear and tear can still break down. Certain part can still break down. Our physical body is the same, subject to nature, manifestation and law, wear and tear as it age. The organ will fail you. You can take medication, you can go through surgery, you can replace some of the parts, but not all the parts, understand? So nowadays people can do plastic surgery to make them look young, but it's not going to last you, understand? No. It's going to develop complications. We are not all the surgery has the perfect answer. They have their own side effect, weakness, and all those things. So all this understanding, you will develop them later on. So anyway, thanks for your reporting so that people can also learn from it. Then for you, especially Pumasuri, don't go into all those things where it's not going to help you. Always remember the four support, then silence your mind, stabilize daily mindfulness. Focus on that. Then develop the contemplative wisdom based on what you see with the mindfulness. Forget about the four elements. Forget about all those insight. The insight, when they arise, the 16 stages of insight, the mind that goes through it, the form and mind will understand. And no need word one. When the 16 stages of insight is described to you, you know what exactly the thing is. Well, your mind has gone through that process. So it's not what they describe one. You don't want to look for it. The one that look for is the thought, the knowledge, not the real. The real one is you awaken. Then you will understand. That is completely different. You go and look for it, one is the thought, the conditioning, what people have been teaching you. That's why the old conditioning need to be rooted out. Now, from now onward, always remember, assume you don't know anything. Everything you find out, don't believe anybody. Don't even believe what I tell you. You have to reflect, contemplate, understand. If it's reasonable, in accordance with nature's law, then you can investigate into it. Then you can find out. You can follow the instruction, like some of the Kayamita did, especially the Han, Sister Han in Singapore. He just did and he found it so simple. And that is what you have to do in meditation. But the instructions are very simple, very direct. It's only the deluded mundane mind that is so conditioned, make it complicated and go and do all those things. And fear, the resistance, because of the conditioning, they want to go back to the old way of doing things. That is where you will get yourself entangled and trapped. So hopefully, this will let more people understand. And at the same time, Paramasri, you can also learn from it. Okay. Let us rejoice. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu. Okay. Anybody else? Paramasri, okay, can understand, good. slowly, it's okay, because for you to go through this as a first time, Song has raised the hand, go to Song, yes.
Okay. Bratio. Bratio, 我要, share 我今天早上的 meditation 的一个 experience， 但是没有 understanding。 我今天早上 我在 morning 我在 sitting meditation 的时候， 然后我可以 我就很 easy 的， 我很 relaxed 的， 就可以 feel 到那个 heart 就是在 vibrating。
对，
然后这个 heart 跟那个 它的 呼吸是 synchronized 的，
在 vibrating， 一体的， 一体的。
然后过后我的每一个 breath 跟每一个它是 那个 heartbeat 是一样的，
一样的 synchronized，
expand， 一直 expand，
synchronized， yes，
我的每一个心跳它就很像一直在不断的 expand， 不断的在 expand 到一个，
you will go through that phase， you will go through that phase，
到一个 boundary 这样子， 就是每一个 你只是 aware 到就是你的 heart 跟那个 breath 是一起的。
Because the breath and the heart, they are connected. Because the breath will end at the heart there. When your anapanasati is very stable, it will drop to the heart. Finally, it will drop to the heart.
Then it will expand to make a heart, the vibration, it will expand, it will expand, it will expand to the
heart. You can get it linked one.
然后我就在里面就一直这样子就 relax 的就去就让它就一直这样子
very good relax relax and just let things be 它自己就会 move 了 that a lot of things will follow then you will understand
okay
沙丘
因为我很久没有做 sitting 了 昨天早上
off and on your try. Just sitting is useful. Off and on just try. Just sitting, you are more easily in that posture of what they call formal meditation. Just sitting has the advantage of the breath. The breath can actually keep you in focus, the anapanasati. But the disadvantage of sitting is your leg is crossed. But don't worry. Just sitting is a very good way of actually gaining back your balance. But the lying down has its benefit because your qi is not blocked at all. So it's fully relaxed and aware. But that one, your energy will not build up, understand? It will not make you calm and stable. But the sitting one will make you calm and stable. So both you must do. So after it has become part of you, then when your mundane mind collapses already, it's up to you. You want to do, you do. You don't want to do, also can. But you will develop the understanding later on. Because when that nature shine for, technically you no need to do. Because you are like fully aware throughout the day already. But before that thing happen, you have to do both. But okay, you can do more lying down, relax, and stabilize that thing. Then if you need to sit, you sit. Last night during the early day, I remember I do the sitting a lot because I haven't met my last teacher. I don't know about the gateway. Then I didn't do the lying down. Until later on when I understand, then I did both. Then I start to develop the understanding that you have to do both. Where the sitting, actually, anapanasati has its usefulness. Because when you want to recuperate, when you want to stay young, anapanasati is very good. That's why last time when I did a lot of anapanasati, I hardly age. But when you lie down and do that one, lying down, you are very relaxed. And your true mind, you stabilize very fast. So there are pro and con. So if you want to develop the ability to have that anapanasati type of energy and mindfulness, then you develop anapanasati. Because when I sit with the anapanasati, I realize I calm down very fast. And I develop that strong calmness, stillness for help. So sometimes if I need to improve my health, I will do some form of sitting. And strangely, I don't know why, I cannot like have that craving to want to go into it deep and make my body young. I don't want really. Yes, I just let things be because this is part of nature. That's why you see how my body go through the aging process. Is now towards the more related to the normal aging already. Yes, not like the early day. Early day when I was 40 something or what, I look like a university student. I doesn't really age at that time. But after about maybe 50 onward, I didn't really look at it. I didn't really want to develop all those things anymore. So I just let things be. Then when I need to rest, I rest. The body need rest. Otherwise, it will fall sick. Especially with the pure energy with me for 30 years already. So it has done its part. Like po yong, after you eat for 30 years, it's no more effect on you already. So you need proper rest means you need proper rest.
Then after 那个 meditation 了过后，我就有开 chanting， 但是我也坐住这样子在听，我发现到我那它是在那个 heart 那边听。对，
listen to the heart。
它是跟那个它就好像在那个 heart 里面这样子，就跟他一起讲，一起唱这样子啊，相应啊，synchronize，它就在心那边那个chanting，那个心是这样子synchronize。
Then that type of listening initially is like not connected with the brain one, but never mind one. Then later on, it will develop the understanding one. Means you actually don't need to link it to the brain one. You don't have to listen from the brain. Yes, most people listen from the brain, but they try to remember things. They try to remember things from the brain. But when you listen from the heart, that listening finally become like one with your nature. One with your nature means the wisdom is listening. You no need to use the memory to listen really. So that is where the difference is. As you progress, you will listen from the heart. So a lot of Kayamita, when they hear me say this, they try to immediately go and listen on the heart. Forget about it. When you are not ready, you go there, no use. Too early. You have to develop it in stages. Yeah? The anapanasati, like stabilize, or whatever training you are doing, the bowing, the sitting, the lying down, the form. Do until your daily mindfulness very stable first. Then when your daily mindfulness very stable, when you pay respect, you are full of faith, mindfulness, awareness, then your heart there will open up. You will come to know and it will start to open up. And then only you start to go there. Or your anapanasati will take you to the heart, the breathing. You will drop there. Then in the form of meditation also same. Somehow you will know how to go to the heart there. Then the awareness will pick up the vibration by itself. So wherever the nature wants you to develop the training, it will go there. Sometimes it's not the habit, sometimes it's the vibration around there. So let it stay there, aware, be with it. Like Kogun say, be with it. Then it becomes very beautiful, it like harmonized, synchronized. Then it moves together, then just aware until it becomes very quiet, very still. Then the awareness also becomes very quiet, very still. Then one day, completely cease. It can happen. So have faith, relax, maintain awareness, develop the understanding, the wisdom, contemplate, go through the Avijja Sutta, then the daily mindfulness. So if you do all this, you will transform. Have a good religious routine, a daily religious routine, then you will do well. Sadhu. Very good. Okay.
Thanks. 因为今天我第一次来，我很久没有做 sitting， 但我一 sit 下去就，哎，怎么跟以前不一样？呀，不一样的，你可以
try。then you put off and on continue to do.
Okay.
We are sitting 也有它的用处的。
因为我要讲是说，because我上一次我讲我不是在 sharing 讲我在洗碗，然后那个
对对对对对。then onward
我发现到 even 我 go back to work 在 daily 我也很容易的就在那个 heart 很容易的就去 aware 到那个 heart 的 vibrating 跟那个 vibration。
好啊，等下我就以为今天早上我的这个
sitting 就是跟着那个 heart chakra 的，有会 link to the heart chakra， but actually
anapanasati will take you there。
但是这个是 correct 的 cultivation。
Correct. Because when you can be aware at that heartbeat, it will become one with it. Then the mind will stay there. It will not run. Means you maintain mindfulness on that heartbeat, understand or not? Be with it until it becomes very quiet and very still. Then you will understand many things. Then from there, the awareness come out. Aware, come out. Then later on, when your mundane mind collapse, then only you can have no dwelling. So initially, you can dwell there. You can stay there, aware from there. Initially, you must be aware from the heart. Outward, because there is where the awareness nature is, the gateway is there. So you stay there, you stay there. Then later on, when your gateway is, you detect it already, when it melts inside, you can decide how much of the life force energy from the heartbeat goes into the nature and how much you want to use it for mental activity. Then you will start to understand one very important thing. Later on, all this, the other Kayamita can also learn. The life force energy that come from our karmic nature, or we call it the supportive karma, the karmic nature. So this life force come as that heartbeat. It give us the pulse of life. So this one, if you take it into the nature, 90% can go in and it will do the work inside. But that one is only for cultivator who can do that. Otherwise, this one is like it will when go into the heart, palm the heart, and send the whatever life force energy to the blood. That's why the blood will have the part of the consciousness energy, the life force consciousness energy. That's why wherever your blood goes, the mind can be conscious, it can be aware there. So that's how sometimes people say the blood is where the consciousness is, because it's from the heartbeat it goes. But the energy that is being used up the most is your thinking. When you study, when you think a lot, when you focus, when you concentrate, it uses up a lot of thought energy. So thought energy is mostly used up in heedless thinking, in emotional activity, when you get angry, when you worry, when you have fear. These are manifestations of life force energy. That's why it makes you very weak. It stresses you up. It weakens your immune system. But when you are a cultivator, most of the time you are peaceful, aware, without thought. That's why you conserve a lot of energy. And your energy mostly goes into your nature and do the transformation from inside. That's why cultivator, cultivate with understanding, it will go into the nature. Yeah. So that one you will understand later. Yeah? So initially the anapanasati or awareness, you can anchor it to your heartbeat because you have stabilized that place. So that is the place where you can locate the gateway and all those things. So when you lie down in the formal meditation, you just relax, maintain awareness and stay around that and let it detect. But whichever that is prominent to you, the awareness there, it will draw you there. It will draw you there. Then you can maintain awareness there. Then when something like happen, the yin yang energy flow in there, you will also know, and very soothing when you will go in. Then you will feel very peaceful, very calm, the yin yang energy very balanced inside there. Then there is no hot and no cold, and everything is very balanced. But before people detect that gateway, most of them still have yin yang energy because they don't have the enlightenment, the wisdom. So their yin yang are always imbalanced. So because of that, certain meditator can experience extreme heat or extreme cold. Then after that, a lot of manifestation. These are due to yin yang imbalance. But for your case, it's good because you already stabilized the awareness at your heartbeat area very long already. So whenever you meditate in the formal sitting or lying down, you can go there. That's why in the daily life also you can feel the vibration inside there. But you need to actually relax into it, continue. You have relaxed, but still not enough. Relax until it become very stable, until it become very quiet, until that thing move as one, like you say, the heartbeat and that the awareness become like one, So you have to wait till like that. Means you are not interfering at all. Understand? Means that trust that nature is doing by itself. You have to go through that phase until it becomes very quiet, very still. Then the transformation will happen. The vibration will become more and more fine. When your wisdom is there, it will become more and more fine, more and more fine. Then when you have less and less wrong view, delusion or what, then all the evil roots, one by one, even the habitual tendency, they will be rooted out. The very fine one also, they will go. Then you will start to have the ability to see things as they are. You are always at peace. And the Dhamma keep on arising. The understanding keep on arising. All this can happen.
But Bharati, 我自己也可以, 刚才你在讲话说, 我的 heart 的 area, 哇, 一直有东西在 pressing。
relax in the every mind state that arises. Relaxation is the most important. You just relax. Because sometimes you're too eager to understand and draw, it's not good.
Okay.
你记得以前呢 ？In the early day, I told you, the life force that came and also that nature's energy, or certain cultivator's energy, like certain great beings, nature's energy, they are too strong, too strong. Then, my heart area, I remember, it was too overpowering. You know, at that time, my nature not developed yet. At that time, in the early years, I have not stabilized it. So I have to continue to relax into it. Otherwise, it's like too strong for me. So I had to relax, continue to relax. Then as I relaxed, I realized my ability to absorb and to actually understand them, to be with them, become more and more stable. Until later on, I got no problem. Until later on, my nature become different. That nature become like stronger than the rest. Then when people draw from my nature, I will know. They will rejoice, and my nature will also rejoice. Because the more they draw, the stronger my nature become. So cultivator is like that. That's why when I draw from those cultivator who have very strong nature, they also know one. They also know one. Because when I can draw from them, means their energy, consciousness-wise, they are stronger than me. But wisdom-wise, may not be. Because ours is the wisdom way first, then we go consciousness way. There are some, they go the consciousness way first. Their energy are very strong. Their occult energy, their consciousness are very strong. But they don't have the Dhamma. They don't have the wisdom way. They learn wisdom their own way without the Dhamma guideline. So sometimes they can have slight difference in view. I won't call it wrong view. They live the life based on their own views, opinion, and understanding. So they have their path. So it's up to the individual, because we develop our own understanding. So far I found the Buddha Dhamma is the most complete and the most direct. That's why the Buddha Dhamma, the teaching is very beautiful, very good. And when you go that way, you are able to develop the understanding of the consciousness way. Because the consciousness way, they didn't realize wisdom and consciousness must go hand in hand. I realized because I have the wisdom first, then when I come to consciousness, I progress very fast. I move very fast. But initially, I have problem to cope with the consciousness. It was too strong for me. Understand? Like in the Wuxia Xiaosuo, the Kung Fu show, you only start to develop the energy. Means the Kung Li. You only starting to develop, not even 1 year. And that great master is maybe 30 years Kung Lik now. So how can you absorb? Even if he want to give to you also, you cannot take an answer. Because too strong. That's why sometimes you see in the show, they fox the energy in. But no use, because very difficult. Because you don't know how to use it, upset, and this is like that. So you have to draw it gradually through understanding. Then I realize when I understand, I know how to relax. Then it doesn't hurt me, It doesn't harm me. And through trust, it melts inside. Then everything stabilized. Over the years, it stabilized. Then now it's 31 years already. That's why it's very different. Very, very different. So all this you will go through. You will also understand. So remember to relax, so.
Yeah,
very good.